In this video, I'm finally going to tell the story of why I ditched a $15,000 signature bass with Fodera, where I went after that, and what it is I'm playing now. And it's a tough story to tell. It's a tough story to tell because it involves two things that are always complex. It involves money and it involves personal relationships. There are a couple of moments in this journey that I am not particularly proud of, and I'm going to make a couple of apologies to people who I really care about and am very sad that we no longer have a working relationship together. I'm also going to share a part of my instrument journey through my career that hasn't really had a lot of coverage. It's not something I've ever really talked about before. My first boutique handmade custom instruments, who I ended up selling them to in the mid-2000s. That might surprise you, and how all of that might be coming full circle all these years later. Before we get to this story, as you may have heard by now, I am on an absolute mission with this YouTube channel. The subscriber count is currently sitting at this number right here, and my plan is to get to this number by April 2023. And I need your help with that. I need you to like, comment, and subscribe. Hit the like button, subscribe to the channel, leave me a comment below. I'm answering every single comment that anyone leaves in the first 2 weeks of every video that I upload. And the ultimate goal with all of this is performing live music. If we can hit these kinds of numbers, it's going to allow me to bring you to places like this so that I can put on a live show and present my music and my art to you in person. Okay, let's get to the story of my journey with instruments, with bass guitars throughout my career. I think the first time I saw a Fodera bass in action was probably in the hands of Anthony Jackson playing with Michelle Camillo. And the first time I actually saw one of those instruments in person, actually touched it, got to play it, was probably at the Bass Center in the east of London. I used to go there all the time as a kid, annoying the hell out of Grant and Nick, playing all the instruments and dreaming about being a professional bassist and having one or more of these incredible instruments. Fast forward a few years, I've moved to the US. I'm attending Berklee College of Music. And while I'm in Berklee, I happen to be there with a few bass players you might have heard of, Tony Gray, Mark Kelly, who's now the bass player with The Roots, and with Mitch Cohn, who was, if not the first, one of the first people to play in Hiromi's trio. He was the connection between me and Fodera. And I remember him taking me maybe in 98 or 99 to meet Vinny and Joey when it was really a lot smaller operation than it is now. And a lot of the bass world and a lot of people connected with jazz and with electric bass in New York were kind of drawn to that place. It was a real scene. We ended up having a really great connection, and I ordered my first instrument almost right away. That first bass with the darker body, the single cut high C. It was my main instrument, did everything with that. And it got to the end of the 2000s, and I started talking to them about, how about we do another instrument that's almost a copy? Maybe I want to try a few different things because I really need a backup. I'd be destroyed if that instrument got lost or got broken. What ends up happening is that one of the newer employees kind of running the business side of things suggests to me that maybe we should make a signature instrument. Maybe this backup bass isn't going to be just a backup, could actually be a signature instrument. So in 2011, I take delivery of this new Fodera, which is a signature instrument. I had the string spacing a little tighter. I think I changed the wood in the heel block. I definitely put a balanced XLR output for recording in the bass. So there was a balanced DI in the bass. That was probably the biggest customization I had done to it. And like most people back then, I got a signature instrument, super proud of it. It's with Fodera, the Stradivarius of bass guitar builders. So I make a YouTube video about it. That video has since gotten over 300,000 views. It's actually been unlisted for a very long time because of what I'm about to tell you now, the saga that all went down about 2 years after I posted that video. And the fact that it was Matt Garrison who said what he said at the time, who we'd been friends for many years at that point. We'd been on tour together when he was playing with Herbie Hancock in the early 2000s. I was opening for that tour in Europe. And then out of the blue, there's this torrent of activity online from Matt directed towards me about this video. Come to find out, Matt is not happy about that. The gist of it from Matt was, hey, what's up? You didn't give me credit for this being my signature bass. You're calling it your signature bass, but this is the Matt Garrison shape. And it was very strange. In hindsight, what I should have said at the time is, hey, have you seen Eric Clapton, Eric Johnson, and Stevie Ray Vaughan, and John Mayer's Stratocasters? There's literally nothing at all except the color of the body that's different about them. Whereas in the signature bass I'd made with Fodera, there were actually some pretty significant changes. Anyway, it wasn't handled great. And to this day, Matt Garrison has not said a single word to me. It was not the ultimate catalyst for me leaving Fodera, but it definitely played a big part in it, in the way the company was being run in the back end. And this is where I should make like just huge apologies to Joey and Vinny publicly. Someday I'm going to have the balls to actually call them up and say this to them in person, because it really hurts me that we don't have a relationship. Like, that used to be a real moment of joy, going to Brooklyn and seeing Joey at the front on the desk, and he was always working on pickups, or like finishing basses. And then I'd go back into the workshop and see Vadim, and then I'd just hang out with Vinny. I'd just watch him work. We'd talk about design, and we talk about sounds and bass players we liked, and like, oh, he always had an amazing new idea or concept brewing, or slightly, you know, he's always tinkering and just wanting to be better. I think that's why I respected those guys so much. They were just, how can we always be at the top? But then the feedback from the fans, from you guys, started to come. It's like, hey, I'd love to play your instrument. I'd love to play that Janek Gwizdala signature bass, but I've also got to buy a car this year. And they are kind of the most expensive basses in production. So when they started to move towards the standard range of instruments, and they were doing some CNC stuff, they could bring the prices down a little bit. And when I said to them, can we do a standard version of the signature bass to bring the cost down? I think it listed close to $15,000. That's an exorbitant amount of money, just period, never mind for an instrument. You really can go out and buy a car or something for that. And I'm not saying the instrument isn't worth it. It's probably worth double that when you think about the design and the man hours that go into producing it. That's why I approached him and said, hey, can we do a standard version of the JG signature bass? And the answer was just a flat no. I got to be really clear that Vinny and Joey didn't have anything to do with these discussions. This was all kind of behind the scenes on the business front. Now, I don't begrudge them at all for sticking to their business model, to them being the Stradivarius of bass. I understand that Bugatti and Ferrari doesn't make an entry-level car for new drivers who can't afford $500,000 or $3 million for a car. So maybe around 2017, met Anders Mattesson through my good friend Henrik Linder. And towards the end of that year, I reached out to Anders saying, hey, you know, I'm thinking of making a change with the instrument I play. The main reason for making a move is to try and make a signature instrument that is way more affordable. And ultimately, towards the end of 2017, I just asked him to knock up a few prototypes for me to see if there was a connection, to see if it was something I would fall in love with as soon as I played it. And in December of that year, I headed to Sweden to try out these three new prototype basses.
Man, welcome. This is Theo.
Hi there.
Yeah, this is Lars.
Hello.
He definitely immediately understood the concept of the fact that I come from classical guitar. I play quite melodically and expressively in the higher end of the instrument. That's really part of my fundamental sound. And the initial prototypes reflected that in the simplicity, and there was maybe just one pickup in the initial bass. Or P bass pickups on the 5-string, the gold one, the original prototype, that the higher register of the instrument was just sang so beautifully. But ultimately, all eyes were on what was going to be my day-to-day bass, the single cut, the high C. Anders had made it slightly chambered, so it was semi-hollow body. It was an amazing instrument. And we started to conceive the plan of, how do we do a limited run of 20 master-built instruments, completely handmade by Anders, and then move into CNC production models of the same instrument for a vastly reduced cost. I played the bass for some years. You've probably seen that. There's hundreds of hours of footage of that. I've used it on tour. I've used it in the studio. I played it on at least two of my own records. And the sad thing about the way the Mattesson relationship ended was that The infrastructure just wasn't there. Anders, as a one-person operation, didn't have the time and the wherewithal to accomplish all the things we set out. In hindsight, I think we set the bar way too high for us. We actually talked about 3 signature instruments, a 4-string, a 5-string, double cuts, and then the single cut 5-string. It was a lot of stuff. And at the end of the day, it just wasn't possible. And it led me to start thinking about the next move, the move I currently find myself in now. I ultimately decided that a signature instrument wasn't the way to go. A relationship like that that I'd had with a couple of companies before was not the way to go. And that I actually wanted to go to a company and just buy an instrument. I didn't want to have to talk to them about signature this and mass production that and price points and all this other stuff. I just want to say, hey, I want to do this, this, and this. How do you think we can achieve that in an instrument? I wanted to be able to trust those people. I want to have them build the instrument, deliver it to me. And that's exactly what I did. I took a trip out to Hamilton in Canada, where the F-Bass factory is, and spent the day with Marcel and his dad, George. And we arrived on something new, a 32.5-inch scale length that Marcel had been raving about and saying, hey, man, I really think this might suit you. I played a bunch of instruments that they had in, you know, in their showroom. Okay, this wood and that thing and that neck and that heel block and this facing and all of these different things that I was able to try out in one day. And we made some decisions and went into production with it. And before I knew it, the bass was here. I put it on. I played the way I play without having to think about it. That was the most comforting and rewarding part of the process. And as a byproduct of doing it the way we did it, I didn't feel under any pressure to make a video, to constantly be updating my social media feeds. This is actually the first time I'm really talking about the bass publicly. So it's really nice to take that leap and to get rid of all that endorsement signature thing and move forwards with a company that I really like and people I've known for a long time that didn't put any pressure on me or them to do anything else besides exactly what we should be doing. They delivered the instrument, beautiful craftsmanship, a spectacular piece of engineering, and I get to play it and I get to share that with you. Now, as I promised at the beginning of the video, I was going to talk about the very beginning of my journey with instruments. Not quite the beginning. I did have a really crappy bass right in the beginning, I guess like most people do, the $300 bass. What happened just after that was I was up in Edinburgh, playing at the Edinburgh Festival, and I found a fretless 4-string wall bass in a junk store, and I think it was maybe £400. It really got me on the path of, wow, I'd idolized Lawrence Cottle. He was my mentor. He played wall basses, and now suddenly I'd found this 4-string fretless, and I was starting to get this feeling for what a high-end instrument could do. Lawrence was very kind to hook me up with Pete the Fish, who's sadly no longer with us, and Pete made me 2 5-strings shortly before I went off to the States, a 5-string fretted and a 5-string fretless. I did tell you, you might be surprised to hear who I eventually sold those instruments to, maybe a decade later, maybe 07, 08. Sold them to Marcus Miller. I actually have no idea if he still has them. I don't really know Marcus. I've met him a couple of times, but he's not one of the guys I really know. I'd be interested to know if he still has them, how much he played them, if at all. And just thinking about this whole process and finding some old recordings of me with my band with that new wall bass. Back in 97 or 98, got me thinking, like, I'm not tied to anyone. Like, I don't have a contract with Fender or Yamaha or Gibson or someone like that. I could get a wall. I could go all the way back to the beginning, kind of where my journey with boutique instruments started, and get a wall. Maybe that would be my celebratory gift to myself if we can make the channel hit 1 million subs. How about that? That's a goal. Maybe I'll get a wall bass when we hit 1 million. That'll be super fun. Let's go. Let's go to 1 million. Like, comment, and subscribe. Like I said, I'm on an absolute mission with the channel. I am not going to stop until we get there and move beyond. Again, it's all about being able to get out on the road and present live music to you, to create art in the same room as you. That has been my goal since I started playing music 30 or more years ago, and I don't see it being dethroned from the top spot of my priorities for the rest of my career. So like, comment, and subscribe. See you guys on the next one.